comrades, I'd first like to thank Unite the the resistance for inviting me to speak at today's meeting. Some of you may have heard me speak before, so I apologise if I'm repeating myself, but it's worth repeating. My name is Maz Saleem, and I am the proud daughter of Pakistani immigrants. My father, Mohammed Saleem, was brutally murdered in an Islamophobic attack just over 2 years ago by neo-Nazi terrorist and mosque bomber Pablo Lapshin. My father was a baker and a trade unionist. Millions like my father, Irish, Russian, Jewish, Eastern European, have all come here to work and seek a better life for their families. My father worked extremely hard. He did double and triple shifts at the bakery to feed his family. He gave more than he ever received. Racism has always played a role of dividing people, and we should oppose it. This country was founded on immigrants. It's been supported and nourished by immigrants, and we must never forget that. Since my father's passing, I've been an active campaigner and speaker on racism and Islamophobia, and currently working as one of the coordinators for Stand to Racism, Delegation of Humanitarian Aid Trips to Calais. And next, third delegation, I've just come back, we spent 4 days in the camp, I've just come back. And this time, my next delegation is on October 17th. This time we'll take as many convoys as possible and march again in solidarity with our brothers and sisters in camp to the Calais governmental buildings and demand the French authorities open the borders and let our brothers and sisters in. Personal experience of Islamophobia will live with me and my family for the rest of our lives. It will remind me what happens when hatred in society goes unchallenged and people who hate are not stopped. On the 29th of April 2013, my father, Mohammed Saleem, 82 years old at the time, had been singled out and murdered on the very road he lived on for over 30 years. The motive for his death was allegedly because he was brown and dressed like a Muslim. He was followed from the home from the mosque after late evening prayers, which were Isha prayers at 10 past 10 p.m. by a cowardly right-wing neo-Nazi terrorist who'd been in the country for less than a week. He was then stabbed brutally 3 times from behind. Surprisingly, the perpetrator was awarded a work placement in Smalley, which is where my parents live, an area densely populated by Muslims for many years. A known racist neo-Nazi in Ukraine was allowed to enter this country to complete a campaign of terror and murder. Now, we can see Theresa May is constantly screening Muslims going in and out of the country as terrorists. How did Pablo Lapshin get to this country within 5 days, murder my father? Now, why single out Dad? Simply because my dad was a Muslim and for no other reason, a practicing Muslim with a beard and someone who is devout to following the teachings of Islam by performing the daily 5 prayers. The devastation of the death of our father has been overwhelming. To even comprehend what our father went through, bleeding to death on the road is devastating, let alone trying to understand how someone could have such hatred for an 82-year-old man. The fact remains, my father was targeted for being a Muslim. He was followed home and killed. Pablo Lapshin from the Ukraine is serving 40 years for my father's murder and the 3 mosque bombings in the West Midlands. These were all acts of terrorism and he was charged under the Terrorism Act. Yet to this day, the media, the police, the government have not treated Pablo like they would if the terrorist was a Muslim. Lee Rigby was murdered, rest in peace. The murder received global coverage, but when my father was killed in a similar terrorist attack just 3 weeks before, Dad's murder received barely any media coverage. There wasn't any condemnations from the government, police, or MPs. So you ask yourself, if a single individual was going around and placing bombs outside churches, what would be the reaction in this country? Is the Muslim community any different? Do we not deserve the same protection and rights? Why? Because the label of terrorism is more widely associated with Muslims and Islam. I'm here today to address the pressing issue of Islamophobia and its increase over the last few years, much of which has been perpetrated by the sensationalised media headlines and the general bias against Muslims in news reports and treatment within the legal system. My father was attacked because he was a Muslim, not because he was Asian. It was because of his faith. Islamophobia is rife, and Islamophobic attacks continue to rise, fueled by sensationalised headlines run by the media and also by the government's stance at treating all Muslims as terrorists. What hope is there for our kids and generations to come if we don't make a stand against all forms of hate? Continuing to whip up racism towards refugees and migrants, David Cameron has refused to let more refugees in, despite the harrowing scenes of people fleeing war and poverty and being left in the Mediterranean. At the same time, Theresa May has continued to whip up Islamophobia by pushing the idea that Muslims are the enemy and they need to be monitored by the PREVENT programme. However, on September the 12th, more than 100,000 people marched around the country to say refugees are welcome here, showing the potential. Showing the potential for people to beat back the racist tide. Now join us outside the Tory conference in Manchester to stand up to racism and to stand up against and to say all migrants and refugees are welcome here next Tuesday. We'll be protesting outside the Tory conference as Theresa May addresses the conference to announce more racist measures attacking migrants and refugees and Muslims. So join us, we'll be assembling at 5:30 outside the Tory party conference, and then we will have our rally straight after at 7 p.m. Thank you.
To introduce our next speaker, somebody who's probably more excited than anybody should be about returning to work. Yay! Somebody who's been mentioned in every single speech so far, Candy Udwin. Yay!
Conference that they supported our strike was fantastic.
fantastic, and that shows what the changes that are going on in this country can mean to all of us. But mainly, I'd like to thank all of you, because actually, it's been the network of people who want to stand up in this country and see an alternative to austerity, to see an alternative to the politics of the Tory party conference. Everything that's going on in that conference is what's bad in Britain. And on this demonstration today, you see everything that's about that's good of it in Britain. It's about solidarity. It's about saying refugees are welcome here. It's about sticking together. And we feel privileged, actually, to have felt that during the course of our strike, because it is, we have had 130,000 people sign our petition. We've raised £150,000 for our strike fund. It's been phenomenal, that solidarity. But if you look at what we have to do next, we have to launch a national campaign that says museums and galleries should be free and publicly run. For the renationalisation of the National Gallery, along with everybody else. And if you want to learn the lessons from us, we say there's three lessons. Be bold, because actually, if you'd asked us a year ago, we would have said two-hour strikes are the best way to win. Now, a lot of us feel like we should have gone for all-out strike action earlier. And actually, as soon as we went on all-out strike action, the support that we got exploded. So there's a lesson there. Be broad. You've got to get everybody on your side. And we've had people up and down the country, not just trade unionists, but people from all over who have given us support. And we've done everything in Parliament and done early day motions. We've done everything. But also, be political, because trade union battles are not just about terms and conditions. And the reason that we've had the support that we've had is because we have connected with people who want to see a political alternative in this country, and that's why they backed us. Not necessarily that they will ever set foot in the National Gallery in their life. And then the last thing, and this is the last thing that I'll say, to be honest, if we can do it, anybody can do it. And if you look at the attacks that we've got, the only reason why they're attacking us is because they're scared of us. And if we can do that in one gallery, think what we can do as a movement if we all do it together. So let's start.